بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. My dear respectful brothers and sisters, today is a Good Friday in the predominantly Christian world, including our country, Canada, and we marked it in our calendar. But I'm taking you back to the last month, the occasion that on the last month, which was the Family Day. So today the topic is about familyhood, how to make a family, or how to keep the family in a proper way. So I just want to target the establishment, the fundamentals of the family. So to associate a family, we need two figures, father and mother. So if the mother and father, or say the husband and the wife, if they find each other, how they can sustain their relationship and how they can progress it and make it in a better way. That is the topic. In the verse that I have just recited in my opening, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that is the first ayah of Surah An-Nisa, So the Surah An-Nisa, the third surah, third chapter of the Quran, the first ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in it, Ya ayyuha an-nas ittaqoo rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida. O you people, O mankind, fear your Lord, the one who created you from a single soul. Wa khalaqa minha zawjaha. And the one who created from that soul, it is mate, it is partner, it is spouse. And وَبَثَّ مِنُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً. And the one who from there spread uncountable number of men and women from these two souls, when they were one and they were made two, and then after that they found each other and they got all those offsprings. In this ayah we can understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that in the beginning there were only one life, one soul, and then Allah divided it into two. When Allah separated this life into two and made them into two, He didn't use it in a way of that putting sword on it and splitting it into two. But it was separated in a form of like cloning system, and where each one becomes an independent entity, why none of the two is deficient, none of the two becomes weak, none of the two is damaged. So both of them are full and complete. And then, but again, they are separate. Why? They have their own relationship. So that way, in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken one, made one into two, why each one is complete, this one has all his or her senses, and the other one has the same thing. So they are still each, this one is in this way. You cannot distinguish which one of these is the original and which one is the copy. But they are all the same. So there's no difference, there's no discrimination between the two, and none is lower than the other. When it is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we can see the history today, we can see the normal life, that one became female and the other one became male, but the two, up to now, we are looking for each other, we search each other. Why? Because if one of us do not have the other one, that one is feeling a kind of incomplete, a kind of uncovered, a kind of unprotected. So it will be to get protection, to be covered, to be to get help, to get someone who accompany with you, to get someone who can make you complete, you need the other one. That is why every guy is looking for a girl. Every girl is looking for a guy. That's how it is. So when it is that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَأَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ. You fear the Lord, the one you ask in His name, you ask Him in your relationship, your kinship, the tie of the relationship. That's what you use. That relationship be from maternal side, paternal side, or marriage side. Then all that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us that a clear evidence. So it is not something that we are looking after, we are searching. It's very clear. And Allah made everything in pairs, male and female. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Dhariyat, ayah number 47, Allah is saying, وَخَلَقْنَا مِن كُلِّ شَيْءٍ زَوْجَيْنِ. We have created everything in pairs, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ, so that they may understand it and they may think about it. So that they may learn lessons from it. Every species in the world is in two pairs, is in pairs, male and female. So we should learn lessons from there. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, you see in many verses, Allah says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَذَكَّرُونَ, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. So, when Allah says, you may learn from lessons from there, means Allah did not say, you should learn, and you will learn, and you can learn. He didn't use all those terms, but He said, you may learn lessons from it. That means Allah is always, what you do is what is you are accountable for. You may learn lessons from this, and you may not learn. There are many, many people who never learn lessons from what is going on. There are many people who do not understand this Islam because they don't have the intention to do so. And that is why the Quran is only a torch, it's a guidance. But it is not law enforcement. It's not forcing you, it's just showing you the way. And it's up to you which way you follow. But in order to know that, first you must know Islam. You must learn the Quran, and then after that, you practice upon it. How can you practice? How can you believe it? How can you act upon it if you don't even know it? So please, brothers and sisters, I encourage you and myself that we keep learning the Quran, the meaning, to understand it. To come back to the topic, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to us, when He made us in this way, He gave us this, He put something in us so that we find each other and we protect each other. What is that? Allah planted in our hearts love, affection, adoration, and intimacy, and mercy. He created all that and planted it in our hearts for the other, the opposite sex. So every man has that feeling for the woman, and every woman has that feeling for the man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Ar-Rum, ayah number 21, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنْفُسِكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا. And among the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, among the evidence, what can show you the truth, among them, is that He created you, He created mates for you from among yourselves. So look at this. He created the soul mate that you need. He created it for you. He created her for you. And he created him for you from among yourselves. So every woman is from the man, and every man is from the man, and they are for each other. In that situation, then we are one. بعضكم على بعض. That Allah always repeats that, saying that some you are from each other. And when it is that Allah says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً, and Allah planted in your heart love, adoration, affection, and intimacy for the other, the opposite sex, so that you have it in your heart for the other one, automatically. That's how you have. And then why it is that? When it is in that situation, then you have to apply it. How Allah put it? First, he puts it the love. The second is mawadda wa rahma. First, you must have the mawadda. Actually, in Surah Al-Imran, ayah number 10, Allah says, زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ مِنَ النِّسَاءِ وَالْبَنِينَ. So there Allah has mentioned the love. So here Allah mentions the affection and the mawadda, the adoration. And then Allah says, وَرَحْمَةِ. Then after that, you have a mercy for each other. It is those steps. Those steps, if you do not follow them, you cannot start to jump to the mercy when you don't even have the love. So first you start with that, and it begins from the first time when you are selecting each other, and then when you live together, it grows up like that. And when you live, the more you live, the more love you have for each other, the more affection you have for each other, and the more mercy you give to each other. That is how it works. So how can we maintain that? That's the whole point now. Where we are going to is how can we preserve that love and that mercy. How to preserve is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us in the Quran. In Surah Al-Nisa, ayah number 19, Allah says, and also in Surah Al-Baqarah, in Surah Al-Dalaq, in many other surahs, Allah says, the wording of وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. When Allah is talking to the husband, he says, وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and treat with them in kindness, in a form of gentleman. So you treat with your wife in kindness, and that kind must be performed in a form of gentleman system. You make yourself a gentleman. And when you make yourself a gentleman and you show kindness, then you show her that you take care of her. You give her love. When you give her love, then she gives you respect. And then harmony and unity and tranquility comes. As in the past ayah, Allah says, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And before that, Allah says, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا, so that you may find comfort. You may find comfort and tranquility and peace with her. And the other side, the opposite side is also the same. وَعَاشِرُهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. So you always do that system of staying together in harmony, tranquility, and peace, and helping each other. When Allah uses here the wording of urf, which I have discussed in the last prayer in my previous khutbah, the last month, that urf is the culture and the customary law and the legal, the legislation, or what you can say, the law, the national law that exists in that place. So you treat with your wife according to the culture that exists there, which is the good culture. We are not talking about the bad cultures. And also according to the law and according to how she will. So you give her the respect that she can show her
big rooms. Your wife, when she is going to see her friends, she must show that she is receiving protection from you and love from you, protection from you. She is receiving all that from you. Then she wants to show others so that she will not be demoralized in front of others. She will not be embarrassed in front of other her friends. That's what you should give her out. From there, it is completely haram that you talk about your wife to other people. It's completely haram that you attack her verbally or physically. It's completely haram that you give her bad attitude or wrong way of dealing. It is haram that you break her, you hurt her feelings by talking to other women, and so then she sees and she feels hurt. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in hadith, which is reported by Sa'id al-Khudri in Sahih al-Muslim, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Inna min ashar al-nasi 'inda Allahi manzilatan." The one who is the worst and the most evil one in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a man. رَجُلٌ يَفْضِي إِلَىٰ إِمْرَأَتِهِ وَتَفْضِي إِلَيْهِ. This is a man who sleeps with his wife and she sleeps with him and they share the bed. ثُمَّ يُفْشِي سِرَّهَا. Then when he gets out of the bed, he starts spreading her shame, talking about her. He's talking about what, how she is, what happened in the bed, and what her bad side. Every human being has wrong, good side and bad side. So he conveys other people as a message that she is bad person because of this and this. That is the worst and the most evil one, as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam described. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says also in another hadith, there is a man, he says, كل أمتي معافى إلا المجاهرين. All my ummah will be forgiven, accepted. The one who want to expose, the exposure, the one who want to disclose always, and that one, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not getting the mercy for the forgiveness. And who is that? He is a رجلٌ يعمل بالليل عمل. In the night time, he did something. Whether it is that's with his wife or something outside there, whether he drank somewhere in outside or he had shisha or something, whatever he had. In the night time, he did something wrong. But and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, ثم يصبح وقد ستره الله. And he comes in the morning while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has covered his shame. All the bad things he did last night are covered by Allah. And when Allah has covered, then the man comes out to his friends and he says to Ya Fulan, Amaltu al-Bariha, kida wa kida. He says, last night you know what I did? I did this things. I did to her such things. I did to him this one. I have stolen, I have did so and so. So he exposes all the bad things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has covered. So it's like that, as Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying, وَقَدْ بَعْتَ يَسْتُرُ اللَّهُ سِرَّهُ وَيُسْبِحُ يَكْشِفُ سُتْرَةَ اللَّهِ عَنَّهُ. Allah is covering his shame, his bad deeds. But he is removing it. He's saying, no, I don't want it. I don't want it to be hidden. So Allah is trying to, Allah is concealing and he's relieving it. He's acting like this way. That kind of person, it is he who doesn't want forgiveness. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, I advise myself and to yourself that I'm talking to the brothers now, so I'm talking about the right of the wife over her husband. the other way you can understand it, and it will be in another khutbah inshallah. So we must feel that we have to keep the harmony and unity and uniformity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to keep. So again, it is completely haram and prohibited that you hurt your wife. Leave alone to beat her up. So to beat up your wife, that's another case. That is too serious. And it is unfortunate that some ulama, maybe they make reference from the Quran to say you can beat your wife. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, that's where they are referring to, those ulama, is ayah number 34, which should be read with ayah number 35 of Surah An-Nisa. And also with ayah number 129 of the same Surah An-Nisa. When you read those ayahs together, then you can understand the word which some ulama has translated to be that you hit your wife or you beat your wife. And this is the first. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in this verse, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم واللاتي تخافون نشوزهن فعذوهن واهجروهن. That is the ayah, but I will continue in the next part of the khutbah. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I'm coming to one point, that is to beat your wife. And then I'm quoting the ayah, ayah number 34 of Surah An-Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاللَّاتِي تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ فَعِذُوهُنَّ وَهْجُرُوهُنَّ فِي الْمَضَاجِعِ وَاضْرِبُوهُنَّ فَإِنْ أَضَعْنَكُمْ فَلَا تَبْغُوا عَلَيْهِنَّ سَبِيلًا. The meaning is that, and for those women from whom you fear disobedience and breaching the law and breaching the normality, admonish them, number one. Number two, refuse to share your bed with her. And the third one is strike. And continuously Allah says, if they obey or if she obeys, and take no further action against her. And do not make an excuse to banish her or to leave her or to give her a hard time. So this, the last one, do not look for excuse to do something wrong to her or do not take further action. Goes back to the previous, like, if she accepts when you admonish her, you give her advice, please, sister, my darling, you are my wife, so and so, it's not good for you to do so and such things. If she accepts it, don't take any further action. And do not look for any other excuse. The second one, you separate yourself from her within the bed. When you two are sleeping in the bed, if she faces the north, you face the south. So then you show her your back. That means do not make any love with her in the bed. So that is the second stage. If she learns lesson from there, then alhamdulillah the whole problem is done. If not, then Allah says strike. So the word strike here in the ayah is wadribuhunna. Strike her or strike them. Wadribuhunna, then ulama differ in the explanation or the meaning of this word. Some say wadribuhunna means beat her up, hit her. But still they say it is very certain circumstance, certain level, certain, so, and you can use only a toothbrush to beat her like this way, not beating her. That is completely, all the ulama, all the Quran commentators are in agreement that slapping and all those stuff has no place at all. But use like toothbrush and strike her like this. Some ulama says that. But many other ulama explain this word
as it is always in the Quran, in the coming surahs, and you can see the context also, which is, first you try to advise her, and she didn't. Second, you separate her yourself from her in the bed. Third one, leave her. Strike means hit, but hit here, it doesn't mean hit her, but it means hit the road. Just leave her. So you leave the house, hit the road, just leave her alone. When you leave her, that is separation. And it's the third stage. If that separation, if she learns lesson from there, then it's alhamdulillah. If not, then the last stage, which is the fourth stage, is the fourth stage, not the last one, is to go for reconciliation, as the next ayah is indicating. Talk about reconciliation. If the reconciliation doesn't work, then the fifth stage is the divorce. So it is that procedure. It's just a process, and it is not that you start beating up somebody who is the same like you. If it is about that, you beat and discipline your wife, then why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the very next ayah number 35 of Surah An-Nisa, Allah is saying, وَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ شِقَاقَ بَيْنِهِمَا فَابْعَثُوا حَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهِ وَحَكَمًا مِنْ أَهْلِهَا. And if you fear that there's a domestic family there in one of your households, then appoint a mediator from his family and another mediator from her family. So those mediators can start from one, but later on it could be two, three, they can make it more. And if those mediators, if they want to reconcile, then Allah says, "In you redise laha, you won't put Allah bainahuma." If they want to reconcile, then Allah brings their hearts together and the problem is over. That is how it is. And in ayah number 129 of the same surah, Allah talks about the case when in the side of women, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, وَإِنْ امْرَأَةٌ خَافَتْ مِنْ بَعْلِهَا نُشُوزًا أَوْ إِعْرَاضًا فَلَا جُنَاحَ عَلَيْهِمَا أَنْ يُصْلِحَا بَيْنَهُمَا صُلْحًا وَالصُّلْحُ خَيْرًا. And if the wife feels that her husband is disobeying her, or arrogant to her, or rebellious to her, then what she should do is to call for reconciliation. So there is no harm of her calling for reconciliation. That is how the system is. The Islamic system is in that way. So to go to the divorce, there are all these steps before them. But before you reach these steps, which are peaceful, peace process, if you go to this peace process, but in the middle if you start punching her, you already broke the peace process. And if you want to reconcile, say, two nations, you can't say when the negotiation is going on, let the other, this one beat the other one. You can't attack, because there is peace and negotiation which is in the process. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I want to conclude in this hadith, that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has forbidden this kind of torturing, beating, hitting of women. And he, in many hadiths, he said you should take care of a woman. Because at that era, it was the era where a man should first buy the woman. And when he buy her, he enslaves her and he beats her up the way he wants. And she is just like one of the utilities in the house. That was the situation. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has the Quran. Allah has forbidden it in the Quran, and the Prophet did so. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in this hadith, أَمَا يَسْتَحِي أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَضْرِبُ إِمْرَأَتَهُ كَمَا يَضْرِبُ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ الْحِمَارُ بِضَرْبِهَا أَوَّلَ النَّهَارِ ثُمَّ يُضَاجِعُهَا آخِرُهُ. This hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim too. So this hadith, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, don't he feel shame, a man who beats up his own wife in the first part of the day and sleeps with her, makes love with her in the last part of the day, which is the night time.
What kind of man is he? He beats her up like she is a slave for him, or like she is a donkey. That's how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says. What kind of man is he? The one who beats up his wife like a slave or like a donkey in the early part of the day, and in the last part of the day, he is seeking love from her. How that can work? My dear brothers and sisters, I will just give the general advice to myself and to yourself that we should keep the unity and harmony of the familyhood so that we can, from home, we can create a nation. So each household, we make that nation. But if we break it down, then the whole nation is gone. And we know the history, it's very clear that if you are a man, it is not guaranteed, there's nobody guaranteed that you are stronger than the wife. She could be stronger than you if you fight each other. And even if she doesn't have that physical strength, she has mental strength. She could easily, when you are sleeping, what about if she stabs you down? What about if she poisons you the food? What about if she, when you are sitting there, she boils water and pours on you? Then she can do all that. She's a human being. So there's no way of beating her. And also, before that, talking about her bad damage, demoralizing her, breaking her heart, all those are haram. Ibadullah Yusuf, Allah Azza wa Jalla. وحذركم بنفس ونفسكم بمخالفة الله وبسعني وذكركم بأمرهم بدأ الله بنفسه ثم أمر بملائكته إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما وأقموا الصلاة